Well, hello, everyone. My name is Pauline Haycock, and I am the celebrant here at Rainers. And before we get started, I just have a couple of announcements. And the first is, if you have a cell phone, would you please be so kind as to turn the ringer off for the duration of the service? And the family will be interring Joe immediately following the service. So you're invited to stay, grab a cup of coffee. We won't be gone long, and then you can share with them the refreshments that are later on. So that's right here in our refreshment area. So please stay. The family's looking forward to visiting with you. So at this time, I'd like to ask you to please rise as the family comes to join us. Whether you are here in person or joining us via the recording on Rainer's website, I would like to thank you for your attendance here today in support of the Spataro family. So, I would like to start with a scripture reading and prayer. The family has chosen the 23rd Psalm. I'm sure you will recognize it. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Would you please pray with me? Heavenly Father, thank you for today. And we thank you for Joe. Thank you for the wonderful example that he set for his family and for his friends. Thank you for the life that was well lived. And Father, I ask that you would comfort his family today. I ask that the words that are spoken here would be an encouragement to them. Again, we thank you for him and for this time together. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, Sophocles was a Greek playwright, and he said, "One must wait until the evening to see how splendid the day has been." And there's a lot of truth in those few words. Looking back on our lives can be bittersweet, bitter for any regrets we may have, but sweet as we ponder the good times. And that is what today is about. Pondering, reflecting back over the years of Joe Spataro. What a privilege it was for me to sit down with his family and hear all about Joe's life and his accomplishments. And that was what we were looking forward to today the most, is the reflecting back and just remembering those good times and to bring a much deserved tribute to Joe. Now, Joel wore many hats over his lifetime, but the two most important hats, the two hats that I heard about, were his hats that were husband and father hats. It's within his family that a man builds his legacy. And it is within his family that a man's legacy matters the most. And when I spoke with Angelo and Dion, it was clear that they loved and respected Joe so very much. Now, Joe lived over 33,500 days. His time was from February 2nd, 1931, to March 26, 2023. And the times that he lived in shaped who he was, who he would become. I love to remind families about the things that happened within their loved one's lifetime because it helps to put that loved one's life into perspective for them. Why they said and did the things that they did. And now, apart from the nature that we are born with, it's our family and life circumstances that shape us. And Joe's generation has lived through an exceptional era, an era that most people today would not have traveled through so gracefully, so selflessly. Joe was born in the winter of 1931, the same year as American baseball player Willie Mays, or that movie star James Dean, or that famous Canadian William Shatner. Those are just a few of those famous people born that year. Did you know that it was expected that boys born that year would reach the age of 58? Well, Joe certainly surpassed that, didn't he? And as a side note, if you were a young person here today or watching, chocolate chip cookies were invented that year too. That's pretty important information. According to the Encyclopedia Britannica, Italy had emerged from World War I in a poor and weakened condition and was struggling to rebuild through the 1920s when the worldwide economic downturn we know as the Great Depression began in 1929. The rural areas of Italy, areas like where Joe was born and raised, faced hardships and people struggled to survive. That was the world that Joe was born into. And most of his formative years were spent in the Depression because the Depression lasted until 1939. And then World War II happened. Imagine growing up in Europe in the 30s and the 40s. Joe experienced firsthand the things that we read about in an encyclopedia or watch in documentaries on television. Those years may have been difficult, but it instilled values, contentedness, and a work ethic in people that is almost unheard of today. Now, I could point to 100 things that shaped Joe and who he was, what I think is more important than that is what Joe shaped and whose life he touched. And of course, most obviously, it was his family and his friends. Joe will be remembered for some of the choices that he made. And just like you and I, some of his choices were good and some maybe not so good. But they changed his life and the lives of those around him. Listening to Angelo and Dion, I realized that Joe was a man who wasn't afraid to take a chance. And I have a poem by Robert Frost that I occasionally like to read at a service, and I think it applies to Joe, so I'm sure you will recognize it when you hear it. Two roads diverged in a yellow wood, and sorry I could not travel both. And be one traveler long I stood and looked down one as far as I could, to where it bent in the undergrowth, then took the other as just as fair, and having perhaps the better claim because it was grassy and wanted wear. So Frost goes on to describe how, though each road seemed equal, after much consideration, he chose the second road, the road less traveled, knowing that he could never go back and do a do-over like we do today. And Frost concludes with an insight that I think best describes Joe and is fitting to read here. I shall be telling this with a sigh somewhere ages and ages hence. Two roads diverged in a wood, and I took the one less traveled by, and that has made all the difference. He could have stayed in Italy, but he was here and he made a difference in our community. So a lot of time has passed since Joe left Italy and took the road that brought him to Western Canada and to life here in the north. And so we're going to hear about his life now. I'm going to ask Dion and Angelo to come, please.
Hi, everybody. Thanks for being here.
Joe Spataro was born on February 2nd, 1931, to Gerlando Spataro and Angela Cacciatore in Yopolo, Gencascio. He was the fourth out of six children and spent his childhood in a small mountain village until he joined the Army in his late teens. After serving his time in the Army, he returned to Yopolo for a short period of time. He then embarked on his next adventure. He traveled by boat for 2 weeks and arrived in Halifax, Canada. He eventually made his way to Montreal in search of better opportunities. As a single man, he had the freedom to travel in search of work. Those travels took him all across the country, from Quebec to British Columbia. He eventually tired of his bachelor days and returned to Yopolo, where he married Carmela on March 28, 1968. Once married, he returned to Canada and started his married life in Montreal. The family of two soon became a family of three as they welcomed their one and only child, Angelo, who was the center of Joe's world. They moved to Dawson Creek, and Joe bought the family home in the early 1970s, where he raised his family and lived for the rest of his life. Joe was the main breadwinner of the Spataro family, a role which he took very seriously. Much of his working life consisted of long days of camp work as a general laborer, primarily for BC Rail. He also worked construction on various landmarks, including the Peace Canyon Dam and the village of Tumbler Ridge. Throughout his working life, he formed lifelong friendships. As a result of hard work and long hours, Joe developed a large appetite. One night, when Joe and some coworkers had been away working, they went to a restaurant for a steak dinner. They were so hungry that night that when the waitress came by to inquire whether they would like dessert, they responded that they would. They would each like their own dessert in the form of a clubhouse sandwich. When Papa would speak of his working days, he would always tell me that he worked hard to bring Angelo to me. He said not only did he have to leave Italy to come to Canada, but he worked very hard to bring Angelo from Montreal all the way to Dawson Creek. And for that, I will be eternally grateful. Family was of utmost importance to Joe. He always put his wife Carmela and son Angelo first. He dedicated his life to make their lives as good as he possibly could.
So my dad worked extra hours at five different locations along with my mom after his regular long days of railway work to help get me through optometry school. I am very grateful that he helped to make my dream come true. I do not know how he found the strength and energy to get through those long days. I had an opportunity to join him on some of his long work days, along with my good friend Tony. And by the time we came home for a late night dinner with him before the second shift, My hands were so sore and so tired, I could barely pick up a fork and spoon to eat my pasta. And he went on to a second job after that evening. His strength and stamina amazes me.
Although Joe was separated by distance from the rest of his family, he always made an effort to connect with relatives by phone and visits when possible. Despite geography, he was able to keep close connections with family members in Montreal, Italy, and New York. These connections were extremely important to him, and throughout the years, he remembered and acknowledged birthdays as well as special occasions. He lit up when he received phone calls from family.
After his granddaughters were born, he had the luxury of being retired and took an active role in childcare during their early years. He routinely took them to swimming lessons in the Red Impala and spent quality time with them in the garden, letting them enjoy the fruits of his labor. Joe was a man of integrity. He treated everyone with respect and expected the same in return. When Papa, Mama, and myself moved from Montreal to Dawson Creek, we traveled by train. All of our belongings arrived separately a short time later, except for a barrel of wine, a very large oak barrel of wine. Somehow it was missing. It was homemade by Papa in Montreal in the basement of the house there. Joe immediately contacted the transport company and inquired about the missing wine. He was informed that the wine had frozen during transport, cracked the barrel, and damaged it. However, Papa knew that his wine was much too potent to freeze, even in a Canadian winter. So he promptly sought legal representation to rectify the situation. A polite demand letter was written, and within a very short period of time, the missing wine barrel appeared at Joe's house, completely intact. Papa never owed anything to anybody, and he always paid his bills or debts promptly in cash. Thus, immediately following the receipt of the wine barrel, Papa provided the agreed-upon payment to Mr. Sam Side, our notary here in town, $20 and a bottle of wine to his legal representation.
Throughout the years, a very common sight in Dawson Creek was a shiny, red 1976 Chevrolet Impala cruising through the streets. Behind the wheel of that distinct car was a distinguished, dapper Italian gentleman, Joe, of course. He was the original and only owner of that prized automobile, which he took much pride in. He was meticulous and took exceptional care of it throughout the years. At 90 years of age, he was required to renew his driver's license, which included both a knowledge and a driving exam. With the assistance of his son, Angelo, he practiced and practiced and successfully passed both of them. What an accomplishment. Joe was able to keep his license for his entire life.
So, some of you might be surprised to find out this next fact, but a favorite pastime of Papa for at least six decades was watching WWE, World Wrestling Entertainment. One day, at 91 years of age, he hurried into the kitchen to tell us about a takedown move he had just witnessed on SmackDown, a show on WWE. He demonstrated the move with much excitement in his voice. And for his 92nd birthday, we gave him a Hulkamania do-rag and t-shirt, which he cried with happiness when he opened the gift, immediately put the items on and wore them continuously. The do-rag actually to sleep every night because his head would get cold when he was napping. Joe also immensely enjoyed cowboy movies, affectionately known as spaghetti westerns. And more specifically, he was a big fan of Clint Eastwood movies.
In the summer months, you would find Joe outside tending to his garden. He was so dedicated to his garden that when he was unable to plant in daylight due to long work hours, He positioned his car after dark and planted using the illumination from the headlights. He was a skilled gardener who provided hours of tender, loving care year after year to a garden full of vegetables, including garlic, carrots, or carrots, as Joe would say, peas, potatoes, and fava beans. At least a third of his garden was garlic, which was planted both in the spring and the fall, and was used in dishes year-round. He spent endless hours teaching us how to garden the Joe way, a tradition that we will keep up in his honor. Joe was well known for his delicious pasta with tomato sauce. He would start making the special tomato sauce before 6 in the morning. It was a lengthy process that would take hours to complete, but was well worth the effort. Restaurant or canned tomato sauce paled in comparison. He was well known for barbecued steak, which he would make year-round on either the outdoor or indoor barbecue.
He was very talented at making sanzitsa, winter sausage, a special dried cured pork sausage which was enjoyed by many. It was an involved process that started entirely from scratch. The meat had to be removed from the leg or the shoulder and was then fed through a hand-operated grinder. The seasoning was done without any sort of recipe or guide. The finished product was squeezed into prepared casings and then cured in the cold room. It turned out perfectly each and every time. Joe shared his sausage expertise by teaching family and friends how to make the popular winter sausage. Papa was an avid Italian winemaker at home. He would make his own wine every fall, and it was a time-consuming process that took up to a month to complete. During the month of winemaking, a wonderful fruity aroma would fill the entire house. The finished product was a popular wine which he would share with friends and co-workers.
Papa was a very intelligent man. One evening, I missed a FaceTime call, and when I returned the call, I was informed it was not from Angelo, but from Papa, who at 92 years of age had picked up Angelo's iPhone and on his own figured out how to make a FaceTime call to my phone. We were truly impressed, and I had a lovely chat with him that night by FaceTime. Joe could solve any problem he encountered. He was very creative and resourceful. Although he was a hard worker, he had a talent for determining the best course of action in the most efficient way possible. He imparted his knowledge and previous experience to those around him. We learned so many useful skills and life lessons that we will cherish and rely on. Joe was the most kind-hearted and generous man. He was always willing to lend a helping hand and help a friend in need. He would never hesitate to provide assistance in any way he could, such as helping a friend move after a long day of work, sharing his garden produce, or offering thoughtful words of encouragement or sound advice. One day, Angelo, his mother, and I were playing Scopa, an Italian card game. I was new to the game and was still in the process of learning. But Papa, he came and he stood behind me, and he subtly and kindly started sharing some hints and tips with me. I don't remember who won the game. I just remember his kind, sweet demeanor. Joe was an incredibly charming and witty man with a wonderful sense of humor. There were always a lot of photos taken at the Spataro household, and say cheese was the common precursor to each and every photograph. This past Christmas, photos were being taken, and the usual say cheese was announced, to which Joe quickly added, and crackers. We had never heard him add and crackers before, and we all cracked up. Whenever Joe would laugh or smile, he lit up the entire room and filled our hearts with warmth and joy. If we were to close our eyes for a moment, we can all hear Joe's voice with that wonderful Italian accent and those very special words we heard him say many, many times. Thank you. Thank you very much. But today, we should be saying thank you. Thank you very much to Joe for enriching our lives and for giving us precious and cherished memories that we will hold dearly, memories that will live on in our hearts forever. Since some of Joe's relatives were unable to make it to the service today, we would like to share some of their heartfelt comments.
So, first of all, from Amanda Spataro, his oldest granddaughter, she had this to say. I've never been good with words, but that didn't matter to my no-no. He was an extremely kind, patient, and calm person, which made it easy to sit and enjoy each other's company. I often spent my time with him snacking on whatever he had for me, like figs or watermelon, because he always made sure the fridge was stocked. He would be sitting watching an Italian drama, or WWE, which I guess is the English equivalent of that. The volume would be atrociously high because he hadn't yet gotten his hearing aids, or he conveniently forgot to wear them. He loved his Lightning McQueen hat, his cookies and cream oatmeal, and never went anywhere without his glasses case that weighed down his shirt pocket. He would sit up in the bleachers during my swim lessons, wearing his indoor sandals so his feet wouldn't get wet. On the way home, he would always offer me a Vicks orange vitamin C drop and call it candy. Those. I called him every Sunday for as long as I can remember. Even the day of his fall. I will continue to treasure these memories and many more. I love him dearly and hope he has found nothing but peace. So now, some words from Amy Spataro, his youngest granddaughter. And thank you for that, Amanda, by the way. Sometimes my memories of my Nono blend together since I spent my time in Dawson during the summers and Christmas. Like a good Italian, he always made sure to feed his grandchildren. The fridge was always stocked with pear juice and clementines because he knew they were my favorite. Somehow there was always a watermelon for him to cut, even though it wasn't in season. To this day, I still don't know how he managed to find a ripe watermelon in December. I remember being really young, and I snuck into the living room to watch WWE with him when I couldn't sleep. I'm not sure if he saw me, but the kitchen floors always creak, so I'm sure he was pretending I wasn't there. I always admired his extensive hat collection. For someone with so many baseball caps, I don't think I've ever seen him in casual clothes. He always wore a button-up plaid shirt and suit-like pants. I love my Nono, and I wish him nothing but peace. Thank you for those kind words, Amy.
The next memory is from Linda Rousseau, Joe's niece. When I heard the sad news, I was heartbroken, saddened that my Zio Giuseppe had left us, but proud that I have so many wonderful things to say about him. He was an amazing father, husband, brother, grandfather, and uncle to many of us. He had the biggest and kindest heart. His generosity goes without saying. Many can say it was a privilege to have him in our lives. He loved everyone around him unconditionally, dedicated his life to taking care of his family, going above and beyond to provide for them, setting the perfect example of what the ideal family man should be. Not only did he adore his family, but he truly loved life, never missing an opportunity to smile and make the entire room light up with his warm presence. Although the years may have aged him, he always kept his soul young, which I truly believe helped him overcome many obstacles. Dear Zio Giuseppe, you are loved, adored, and truly missed. You will be in our thoughts forever. And the last memory is from Johnny Spataro, Joe's godson. Johnny wanted to share the story of his communion with his godfather. Johnny said they had been waiting in line for a long time, and Johnny was so hungry that he ate part of his communion candle. Because he had ingested the wax, the communion had to be postponed for 3 hours, as he was supposed to fast for 3 hours prior to the ceremony. Due to this delay, Joe said he could not wait around, as he had to return to work. Joe was such a hard worker, he even missed his godson's communion. As you can see from the memories shared, as well as all of your own memories, Joe was the most amazing man who stole all of our hearts and left a lasting impression on each and every one of us. In our hearts, we will hold the memories dear and treasure the moments and keep them near. Our love for Joe will never sway or bend. It will live in our hearts and never end.
Thank you, everybody, for being here. Thanks for paying respects. If you're so inclined, have a glass of dry red wine at dinner tonight. He would really appreciate that. And you can toast Papa. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Angelo and Dion. Wasn't that fantastic? It just painted a wonderful picture. I was really excited to get a copy of the eulogy, and I will confess that I did not read it in its entirety because it was so well written, I wanted to enjoy them sharing it. So you did a great job, a beautiful tribute for your dad, Angelo. Thank you. Recently, I learned that the first photograph of a living person was taken in 1938 by a man whose name I cannot pronounce, and so I'm not telling you his name, just so you know. The photo shows a lone person on an empty avenue in Paris in the middle of the afternoon. What is odd about the picture is that the streets and sidewalks should have been busy with pedestrians, horses, carts, anything at that time of the day. Yet nothing can be seen there but this man. The man wasn't alone. People and horses were there on the busy street when the photo was taken. They just didn't show up in the picture. You see, the exposure time, or the time the shutters on the camera had to be open to process the photograph, took 7 minutes to capture the image. And whatever the focus of the photo was had to be motionless during that time. It appears that the man on the sidewalk was the sole person photographed because he was the only one standing still. He was having his boots shined. Sometimes stillness accomplishes what motion and chatter cannot. So as we stop now and watch the pictures of the slideshow, it is my hope that Joe will come into focus for you and that you will be reminded how he influenced you as you spent your time with him. So could we please have the PowerPoint?
La gente del quartiere m'ha visto tante sere al solito balcone a sospirar. Diceva per chi viene, pensava chi vuol bene, ma chi sarà colei che vola amar? È un cuore amante che puntualmente m'aspetta qui ogni sera per sognar. Canto, 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 voce piena, la più bella serenata, serenissima sirena. cambiare d'acconte il sentimento del mio cuore, e il mio amore non avrà tramonto. Ogni sera al suo sipario mi presento sulla scena da corazzare la mia chitarra, e sfogliando il mio rimario con lo sfondo della luna canta il cuore amore. Canto, 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 voce piena, la più bella serenata, serenissima sirena. La canzone dice che il mio amor non morirà, tanto voce piena e son felice. Da 7 mesi un giorno io sono qui di turno, lei timida m'ascolta al suo balcone. La luce vedo accesa ma la persiana è chiusa e sogna nel sentir la mia canzone. Il vicinato ha reclamato ed io chiedendo scusa canto ancora. Canto, 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 voce piena, la più bella serenata, serenissima sirena. Canto e le racconto il sentimento del mio cuore, che il mio amore non avrà tramonto. Ogni sera al suo sipario mi presento sulla scena da corezzare la mia chitarra, e sfogliando il mio primario con lo sfondo della luna canta il cuore amore, amore. Canto, 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 voce piena, la più bella serenata, serenissima sirena. La canzone dice che il mio amor non morirà, tanto voce piena e son felice. Canto, 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 voce piena, la più bella serenata, serenissima sirena. La canzone dice che il mio amor non morirà, canto voce piena e son felice. Canto, canto, canto voce piena, la più bella serenata da...
Oh, taught my heart
Well done, family. Well done. My heart's just feeling a little full right now. I'm sure I can't imagine how you're feeling. Do you know the definition of character? Webster's Dictionary says character is the mental and moral qualities distinctive to an individual. Over and over, as I prepared for the service today, I have heard about Joe's character. Angelo and Dion spoke of him with pride and respect, and contributors to Rainer's tribute page described Joe as a devoted husband and father who dearly adored his family. People said a true gentleman, lovely, kind. Well, today at this celebration of Joe's life, we have seen and heard proof that a good reputation is valuable, as we heard about a man of quality who lived a quality life, setting a good example for those he cared about the most, his family. Proverbs 3, verses 3 and 4 says, "Never let loyalty and kindness leave you. Tie them around your neck as a reminder. Write them deep within your heart. Then you will find favor with both God and people, and you will earn a good reputation." And Proverbs 22, verse 1 says, "A good name is to be chosen rather than great riches, and favor is better than silver or gold." Family, weren't you rich to have been a part of Joe Spataro's world? I'd like to close with one of my very favorite poems, and so fitting for today. It's called "The Successful Man." That man is a success who has lived well, laughed often, and loved much, who has gained the respect of intelligent men and the love of children, who has filled his niche and accomplished his task, who leaves the world better than he found it, who has never lacked appreciation of earth's beauty or failed to express it, who looked for the best in others and gave the best that he had. I think that's a wonderful description of Joe. Let's close in prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for this time. And Lord, I just ask that you would comfort Joe's family. Just in the days and weeks to come, would you please be especially near to them as they face these days now without him? I thank you for him and the difference that he made and just the lovely, beautiful person that he was and how he touched the lives of so many. We just thank you again for this day and for Joe. In Jesus' name, amen. Ladies and gentlemen, would you please rise for Joe?